My dad told me that he started to look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 10 downwards. So I went through it, and there's one thing that verse 11.
Oh, we've not
gone to chapter 6, verse.
We've not. Have you gone to the verse 11?
Yeah, he said he was reading something. Maybe.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
We'll get there.
Okay. Pastor, please, you can continue with your submission. Please.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. With the verse 11, there's one thing that I discovered, that put whole armor of God. When he said that way, normally we take it that you become a prayerful, you can fast, you can learn the way of God. That's how we put in our mind, or that's how we take. That's what the Bible is saying. But to me, I see it in those things is added, but it's not only that one. When the Bible says put on the whole armor of God, it means there are some little things that we overlook them. But there are the dangerous things that are weakening Christian life. Like backbiting. When you become a Christian, you need not to backbite your brother or your sister. When those things are in, you are not putting on the whole armor of God. Two, something that you hate within you. Let's assume that I've hurt you, and I've gone to apologize that, oh, but Moses, I've sinned against you. I've apologized, forgive me. Within you, thereby you can say you're forgiving me, but within you, you are not. When that thing comes, it's in the full armor of God that you are putting, you are not. So anytime the terror of the Satan or the demon will rise, it will hit you.
That's true.
It will hit you down. So you'll be thinking you are praying, you are fasting, you are studying the word of God. But why that anytime the terror of the Satan or the demonic terror will raise, it knocks you down. Christian, having take a look of this thing, we read it. And then, with our little understanding that we have, that we pray, we study the word of God, we fast, that makes us be full, put on the full armor of God. No. And when we have such things in us, yeah, to me, it tells us that the armor of God is more well fixed, it is more well prepared in us. So, any time that we it will knock us down. It's a little thing that I've seen in verse 11.
Wow, powerful. 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 Perkin, do you know why I'm quiet?
Yeah, I don't know.
That is powerful. Do you know, as I continue to do further studies into this part, the Holy Spirit led me to something very similar. And that was exactly what I was going to start with. You remember at the verse 10 of Ephesians 6, we spoke about the schemes.
The schemes, yeah.
And
yeah,
our pastor is telling us about bitterness.
Some of the schemes, yeah.
Paul clearly explained some of the schemes. And I believe the Holy Spirit is using our pastor to bring to bear some of the schemes. You know, when the Bible talks about the schemes, we look at big pictures. The devil coming against us with weapons, guns, or something very strange, but they are the little things, like the Bible said, that it's the little foxes that destroy the vineyard.
Yeah,
that's right.
Let's look at something in Second Corinthians,
okay?
And then, Pastor, this is just to support the powerful revelation you brought to bear. This armor that we have to put on, again, like Pastor Amor is saying, there are petty things that makes us weak. In the realms of the spirit, petty things, and one of the things Paul addressed was unforgiveness. I'm happy the master has touched on bitterness. We will see very obviously that unforgiveness is one of the schemes
that the devil will use.
Of the devil. So when Paul was saying that, lest we become ignorant of the schemes of the devil, Paul was specifically addressing unforgiveness. So if you're a Christian and you have unforgiveness in you, how can you tell me you have put on the whole armor? You see, So if you would like to read with me, please. Second Corinthians chapter 8, Second Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 8 to 11. With your permission, Pastor, please let me read this very quickly. And then it will support what you are saying, that bitterness, unforgiveness, malice, hypocrisy, all these things are weapons of the devil against us. But we don't know.
Yes.
And then we will go and quote Ephesians. It says, put on the full armor, then we start, cover. My brother, if you have unforgiveness in your heart,
you are making noise.
Your armor is incomplete.
Yeah.
So, 2 Corinthians chapter number 2, verse number 8 to 11. I urge you, therefore, to reaffirm your love for me. Another reason I wrote to you, this Paul talking, was to see if you will stand the test and be obedient in everything. Verse 10. Anyone you forgive, I also will forgive. And what I have forgiven, if there was anything to forgive, I have forgiven in the sight of Christ for your sake. Why? So that the devil will not take advantage of us, for we are not unaware of his schemes.
And let's bring another word of schemes here.
You see, so this is the schemes, or these are some of the schemes that the devil uses. Instead of us to look at these kind of things, the little things that destroy the vine, we are going after the witches and the demons and all these people, thinking they are the ones we are fighting against. These are some of the things we need to deal with before we can take authority or secure our place in Christ. So, Pastor, this is just a top up of what you just said. Very, very insightful. It is true. We as Christians, we have to be careful with the little foxes. So, Pastor, God richly bless you. If that is what you spotted on the verse 11, God
bless you.
Bless you. God bless you.
God bless you, Pastor.
Thank you.
God bless you. So if you don't have anything to say, then I can continue. And if you have anything, then you will join us, please.
Oh, you can continue, Pastor.
No, I am Brother Moses. Brother Moses.
You are more than
you know, there's one thing in the Bible, when the book of Timothy was saying that anyone that has accepted Jesus as his personal savior is a prophet in his family. He's a man of God in his family. In the little corner that you are, you're a man of God over there. So you're a man of God because you have a family, you have people listening to you, and they take blessings from you. So you're a man of God, you're a pastor.
We thank God. We thank God for that. Thank you so much, Pastor Amo. I'll be expecting your contributions as we progress, please.
Okay, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Minister, that was a powerful revelation from Pastor Amor. This is what the Holy Spirit gave me to start with. The schemes. If you read 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 11, so that the devil will not take advantage of us. Lest we don't know his schemes, we don't know his strategies. So one of the strategies of the devil is unforgiveness, the bitterness, like our father is saying. It is so true. It is so true. So a lot of Christians who are praying against principalities and all these people, but then they have this bitterness in them. You are not fully armed. You are not fully armed. You're not fully armed. So God bless
us. So that you can't fight him with those things.
No.
If you are not fully armed.
No. You see, these are the key things the Bible wants us to work on. Love, the fruit of the Spirit.
The fruit of the
you
Spirit.
You see it? Yeah. Okay, so since I've dealt with that with you,
let's move on.
Okay. So by the grace of God, Minister, we are continuing. Ephesians chapter 6, verse the number 10. And last week, we dealt with the principalities and powers. By the grace of God, we're able to know that is not the work of a believer. If you're a child of God, God didn't give birth to you to come and fight principalities and powers. And then we saw the reason why we are not supposed to be fighting those people. Our real fight is to win the soul. And very clearly, if you want us to read that part again, we can read that part again.
Just hold on, when Pastor Joe called, Amwa called, and I will connect him.
You connect him, yeah. This is for the believer to know that Jesus has done a great job for you and I. And we have to take advantage of the job that Jesus has done, the finished work of Christ. We have to believe it and make it our possession and walk in it boldly. Boldly. Because if, like I've been saying, if you believe that Jesus died for your sins and you don't want to believe that Jesus has dealt with principalities for you, then I don't know what we can do to help you again. Yeah. Why do you choose to believe that, oh, Jesus has taken my sins away? If I believe in Jesus, I'm a child of God. That's what you believe. But that is not all.
Yeah.
There are more that happened on the cross. And by the grace of God, we are getting to know gradually that, oh, so it is not just about Jesus hanging on the cross and dying. Things were happening. Things were truly happening. Brother Ken, and if you would like to read with me the part that the Bible says that he disarmed principalities and powers. Colossians chapter 2, verse number 14 and 15. Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, verse number 14 and 15. Not only about in greetings to you, greetings to Minister DeBlue as well, and all our fathers in the Lord, Reverend David Apo, Evangelist Adama, all the men of God who join this program and who follow us. God richly bless you. So Colossians chapter number 2, I'm trying to get the memory verses on the screen. So listeners should forgive me, I am the engineer, and the, so sometimes, even when I'm listening to playback, I realize that I don't complete some of the statements. Oh my goodness. And I'm like, ah, but it looks like I was saying something. How come I didn't finish it? So please forgive me if something like that happens. So Colossians chapter number 2, verse number 14. This is one of the things that happened on the cross. And I'll be reading from the NIV version. Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, verse number 14 and 15. Okay, please, I'm reading from the King James Version.
Colossians 2, 14.
Yes, please. Colossians chapter 2. My Bible app is playing up. Okay, so let me start from the verse 13, so that we will get a clearer picture. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive. He's talking about us, children of God. God made us alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins. You see, this one we believe. We believe that Jesus has forgiven our sins. Okay. The next one, it is difficult for us to believe. Having concealed the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us, he has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. That's what we believe. And having disarmed principalities, that part we don't want to believe. And having spoiled, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in him. King James says in it, but if you read the original Greek, it says in him. So this is one of the things Jesus did for us on the cross. So it will be quite unfortunate on the part of believers to be fighting principalities if Jesus has already dealt with them.
Let me read this this version.
Please read your version.
On the verse 15, he says, and having disarmed the powers of authorities, he made public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. So publicly, he made this.
Exactly.
Your version is different. I want to make this
other version.
Other version, like publicly, he made this thing happen. So your question is why we still not believe.
It's too difficult. We find it strange that I have powers over principalities, because we think principalities are some demonic powers in the heavenly places that we can't overcome. Like I said last week, we are not powerful because we are powerful. We are powerful because of Jesus. And that is what Jesus dealt with them on our behalf. So the fight was fought by Jesus on our behalf. Why do you think the Bible says that we have overcome? What did we do to overcome? You only say someone has overcome when the person has fought a battle. You see it? So the Bible says, for whosoever is born of God overcometh. Not that the person shall overcome. The person has overcome. That means you are enjoying the victory that Jesus has given you. But that one is difficult for us to believe. We don't want to accept that. We still want to fight principalities of ourselves. We still want to fight the powers of ourselves. And I think clearly it's an error.
Yeah.
It's an error. Today we will go a little bit deep in what kind of prayers we are supposed to pray and how we are supposed to pray. So it's that part is done. We are not supposed to fight principalities. Okay, so let's go back to Ephesians 6 and then do justice to the rest. Ephesians 6:10 down. So finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. We've spoken about that. The next one that we want to discuss today is against the rulers of the darkness of this world. That is where we've got to, and that is what I would like us to deal with today.
Okay.
Against the rulers. But again, notice very carefully, he didn't say we are fighting against the darkness. But the fight we are in is against the rulers of darkness. Darkness is symbolic of unbelievers. Because the devil is not sitting in darkness, ruling over darkness. It will not make sense. If the devil is not in light of, and then he's ruling over light of, no. Biblical language, when we say darkness, most of the times it stands for unbelievers. And we will go into the word of God, we will know very clearly that if the Bible says rulers of darkness, the rulers, the governors, the controllers of the dark world, where we used to be, any unbeliever is in darkness. Why do you think Jesus said, I am the light of the world? And anyone who believes in Jesus becomes the light. So if Jesus is the light of the world, who is the darkness of the world? It's the devil. And anybody who believes in Jesus becomes the light. So the people who don't believe in Jesus, they are darkness. So when the Bible, Paul was explaining to the Ephesians that we are in contention with the rulers of darkness, he's talking about the god of this world who has blinded the minds of the unbeliever. So, but again, very clearly, we now know that darkness means unbelievers. Let's look at something. The Bible's explanation of darkness. Let's read Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 8. I want to put the scriptures on the screen so our dear viewers and listeners can verify what we are saying and do more studies on that. The aim of this discussion is to help somebody or some children of God to increase in knowledge so that we will change our style of prayer and then the way we relate to God. So Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 8, it explains something there for us to know that the rulers of darkness is not referring to the witches in our family and then the witches in our, the demons. No, not at all. Because Bible language, darkness means something. Okay, Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 8. For ye were sometimes darkness. We, the born again child of God, we were sometimes darkness. So we see very clearly. This darkness. Says,
for you were once.
We were once, yeah, darkness. This is in darkness. King James says we were once darkness, which has the same interpretation. We were once in darkness. So rulers of darkness, what are they rulers over? It is not the absence of light. He's talking about people. You see it? For you were once in darkness. So the rulers of darkness was once in charge of our lives. That is the biblical interpretation. So anytime we hear rulers of darkness, we should not attribute it to witches and all these people. No. He's talking about the rulers of unbelievers. Okay, so ye were sometimes darkness, but now we are light in the Lord. You see it? We were darkness. We were in darkness. Now we are in light. So when we were in darkness, someone ruled over us, the ruler of that darkness. He is the, or whoever the person is the one we are in contention with. And what is the contention about? For us to get people out of the darkness into the light. And that is why we need to put on the full armor. So you will see very clearly that in the arrangements of the armor, Paul brought in evangelism, the gospel of the peace, the readiness for the gospel. So we will see very clearly. So for ye were sometimes darkness, but now ye are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. So you see our responsibility is to walk as children of light. Okay. One more scripture, please. Let's go to John chapter 3, verse number 19 and 20. John chapter 3, verse number 19 and 20. So that we will hear from the master's own mouth, Jesus. What did Jesus say about this darkness and then the ruler? So that we can place it in context and know that this ruler of darkness is not the witches in our family. Those people need salvation. We are supposed to walk in light. So that when we shine, we can bring them into the light. You see, that is where the fight is. So the fight is for us to bring those people we are thinking they are demonic, they are this, they are witches, they are whatever. We have power over. So we have to keep going after them with the word. Preaching to them, even when they don't want to hear, we have to go up after them, one after the other, preaching the gospel. Whoever wants to believe can believe. That is the fight. That is the contention. So John chapter 3, verse number 19 and 20. Let's hear what Jesus said very clearly so that we will know that we have a job to do and we will not waste our time fighting principalities. It's a waste of time. There's a job to be done. Okay, so John chapter 3, verse number 19. John chapter 3, verse number 19 and 20. John 3, 19 and 20. This is Jesus talking. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men loved darkness. Men loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hated the light. So you see, those people, we think they are witches. They hate our light. They hate it. They don't like it. Neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth the truth cometh to the... Let me go to NIV. I don't like this cometh. NIV. John chapter 3, verse number 19.
It's a caller.
There's a caller. Okay. Please.
It's a caller.
Oh, my master. Hello, my master. Good evening. My master, we've missed you a lot. Where have you been? Evangelism. Oh my goodness.
Fortune,
This is what we need. You see, also, The Bible contains the letter and the spirit. The letter, or because I'm so many things will
come to your mind.
When you go beyond the letter, the letter is where information is. But when you go beyond the letter, then you tap into revelation.
Exactly.
It is beyond the letter. When revelation comes through the scriptures, and when I will say you are increasing in knowledge. Because now you don't apply anything the scripture says literally. You see it from the spiritual perspective, and then you bring it into your everyday life.
Why do you say we are on the last days? We are on the last days of war. Revelation.
That's right.
But we don't want to tap into that revelation, the word of revelation. What is it? Said as you are saying that, okay. She's going deeper through the word and tap from the revelation. But because we are on the end time, but why are we not getting to the revelation? So that God will give us the revelation of the end time.
You need to unveil yourself.
That's right.
You need to unveil yourself.
What Mama Esther is saying now, because she tapped deep into the world.
I don't know if you heard what she said.
Yes. Yes.
God give us power over snakes and
scorpions. And just scorpions. So who
is that? So now we're a drunkard. That power has been given to you. That and Sanono was a snake, was a scorpion.
So that's where you should condemn it and then move.
Exactly. You take authority over Sadiel and then you help other people who were like you.
That to come into the
light. That's deep. That's deep. Mama Esther, your mission.
Mama Esther, bless you.
Timonakin, John chapter 3. Now, you call the next one. I think our fathers and mothers in the Lord are taking over. We are excited about that. Let me show. But again, John chapter 3, let's finish it and then we move on to the next one. John chapter 3, verse number 19. I said, this is the verdict. Light has come into the world. We are still, if you just join us, we are talking about the rulers of darkness. Rulers of darkness. You're not fighting the darkness. We are fighting the rulers. Darkness, no. That's where they are.
They are there.
But someone is controlling their minds.
Ruling them.
Exactly. That's why we need the armor. Because going there.
You need armor to go there.
Exactly. And this armor, we've explained very clearly, it's not armor, physical armor. No, you get to know the armor. Remember, we talk about misinformation. Yes. Remember, the God of this world has blinded their minds. Misinformation. Misinformation.
Like Thomas have.
Exactly. Exactly.
You get that.
Exactly. So this is the verdict. Light has come into the world. But people loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light. You see why people are still in darkness.
Yeah.
And will not come into the light, for the fear of their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, like we have. And so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God.
Amen.
So that's why we are after the ruler.
To bring those people out.
Exactly. So the prayer of efficiency is to break the forces. Whatever is confusing their minds, that information, bringing down strongholds, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are mighty through God, through the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations.
That's right.
The God of this one now, are blind on my mind. They have a lot of imaginations in their minds. It's Nyakupon, they say then they use Bayern imaginations. They are only imagining things. See, so we need to cast those imaginations down or anything that exalts itself above the word of God. That is where the fight is. That is the real fight.
But it's not about this is serious.
You see,
what you are saying, Moses. So for all these years, until last week, I said, for all these years, we think we are fighting the devil with the witchcrafts, with the witches. But it's not like that. It's not like that. If we have to follow the word, like as we are discussing now, we know that we have missed all this time for praying against those forces, which they are not.
It's not too late. God has a time in the season that
like what my sister said, she believes that everybody will hear this, I mean will connect to this teaching at least for 3 people, 5 people, 10 people so that they can reach to others.
Exactly.
For which you know that we are not here to make up our own stories or our
everything
own
we are reading is from the Bible. It's
coming from the Bible. That's as simple as that.
Exactly.
You see. So I'll let you continue because
I can have a question. We've been fighting these people for years. Have we defeated them?
Have we defeated? That is what I said. We'll continue.
If we have not defeated them, when are we going to defeat them? Tell me.
There was something I was reading earlier. I did a study within the week. Romans 8:37. If we can read it,
okay.
It's a national anthem to every born again, every Christian. If we can quickly read
Romans chapter 8. Verse number 37.
Romans 8:37. Then you kind of just want me to. Why do we say those things and we still don't feel ourselves? We don't feel in ourselves that we are that we think we are.
Romans 8:37. No, in all these things, we are more. I love this. We are more than conquerors.
So
through Him who loved us. So our conqueror. It's through somebody.
But are we?
No,
that's what we are.
No, we don't want to believe this one.
Ah.
No. Ah, how can I believe I'm a conqueror? Me.
But we use this word very commonly.
I don't want to.
You don't want to. You see, if you are a conqueror, but it's not a small word. Though.
That is what is affecting Christians.
You say you are a conqueror.
We don't want to believe these parts. We want to believe the part where the Bible says, oh, God will bless you. That's what we believe. But you are more than a conqueror.
If you are more, you see, you are not conqueror. You are more than.
I love this.
So if you are more than, why do you still fight things that have been fought already? You should be doing things differently.
Thank you. And that is the agenda of this platform. We will look at the scriptures again and do things differently according to how the Holy Spirit.
When I was doing a study, this is what it came into my mind about this Ephesians 6, and I said, so if you are more than conqueror, that means that those principalities and those powers, you are more than them.
Thank you. There is something I missed out about this principalities thing. There's something I intentionally missed out, but you have brought me back.
You are more than them. You are more than, but we use this word merely just to say it.
Do you know what Jesus did again to them? I decided to leave that one. After he defeated them with the same day.
Yes.
Let's read another one that he did. He did it to these people.
To this.
And then he, okay. Yes. This is the beauty of the word of God.
We'll come back to the 19 anyway. Don't jump on that one. We'll come back to it. John 19:20, we haven't finished that.
Okay. So let's go to Ephesians chapter 1. Let's look at what he did to these powers.
Yes.
Ephesians chapter 1. Okay, we were going to go there anyway because.
Yeah, we have mistake.
Yeah. Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 19 to 21. Verse number 19 to 21. Let's see what he did again to the principalities. Because it looks like those are the people that Christians fear the most.
Mm-hmm.
But I said that last week, they are not different. Those people are not different from the devil. They are not more powerful. They are department of the devil. They are branches.
Mm-hmm.
But in all, to put all of them together, Jesus has given us power over all of these people.
Mm-hmm.
When he rose up, he said, all power is given unto me. So these people, their names sound intimidating, but they are not.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not forget, the Bible told us that the devil roars like a lion.
Mm-hmm.
You see it? So the devil will always intimidate you with his name. Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 19.
Mm-hmm.
And what is Ephesians chapter 1?
We're starting from 19.
Yes, please.
Okay.
And what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us? Towards us. NIV says, for us.
Mm-hmm.
The greatness of God's power is for us. Mm-hmm. It is towards us. Okay. Who believe, those of us who believe,
mm-hmm.
God has great powers for us. Okay. According to the working of his mighty power, 20, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, here comes a punchline. Far above all principalities. After he defeated them in Colossians 2, God lifted Jesus and us. Because what Jesus did, we were in him. He did it for us. Jesus left them and God gave Jesus the power to sit ahead of them or on top of them, far above, not even close. So these people, they're not even closer to where Jesus is sitting. And guess what? When Jesus is sitting, he's sitting on our behalf. So we are seated with Christ, far above these people. You see our position in Christ. So we have belittled ourselves and rendered the work of Jesus with no effect, little or no effect. But by the grace of God, we have known the truth that, oh, these people, Jesus dealt with them. And he's seated far above. The power that he gave towards us is the same power. If you read other versions, it's beautiful. He said the power that God has placed in us is the same power that he raised Christ Jesus with and placed him far above. It is the same power. So why are we then scared going to church, always fighting these people? They themselves know we have power over them. But because we are ignorant, they are happy. Because exactly, these people, they don't even know that.
That is what I believe is, it's only Jesus carries that power. We don't carry that power.
Exactly.
That is our mind.
Exactly.
He is the only one who died and resurrected. But he said he died with our sins.
Exactly. On the cross.
On the cross.
For whom?
For me and you.
And you think he defeated the principalities for himself?
No. Yes. But now
he didn't need to do that.
We believe, as you all know, as we all understand, if we are not coming out, we'll be steady. Which is all we know is only Christ who can. We want to tap the power from him. But he's already giving us
the power. Already giving us. We just have to know the truth. See,
so what you are saying is, until you go deeper in the way, to search, to understand, you won't come to this knowledge.
This knowledge, exactly. And we need to increase in knowledge.
You won't come to this knowledge to know that there's a power in you. It has been given to you already to do all these things. And more than conqueror. Exactly. So that is where you can use
greater is he that is in you.
You see, that's where you can say, I'm more than conqueror. Because there's power in you to say that.
Exactly.
So that you can conquer those things that you need to conquer to bring those people from darkness into light. If an army going to a battle and he know he is more than conqueror, Moses, he can reach to every corner and kill and get to the people who have been maybe they want to rescue people. They go into the camps and kill and rescue those people because they try to say, I'm more than conqueror. But are we?
Do we
only still tap in from Jesus to do it? Do it. Just in the name of, you see, but we are not doing what we think he has given us that power to do it. So I think that is what we lack.
The faith and then the belief.
The faith.
To believe, we need to believe that Jesus did it for us, and he's not going to do it again. He has done
it. He has done it once.
It is done.
So
once he's done it, he's done it.
It is the problem we are having, and we'll be having it for a very long time.
By grace of God, you change.
But we have to change our mindset, as you say. We change our mindset maybe 10 years ago. And we're still sitting at the same place with that mindset. Without renew your mindset, maybe every year or every time that your mindset needs to be renewed.
Exactly.
You don't renew your mindset for just when you become born again. And you're still sitting at where you are sitting.
That's what the Bible says, steady to show yourself.
You see,
you have to keep
so the mindset needs to be renewed as you grow
daily
in the spirit. So that you can understand things, and then you grow in the knowledge, and then and the word, the understanding of the word. You grow in knowledge in spirit.
That's right.
And if you don't grow in knowledge in spirit by his grace, how would you understand the scriptures or what we are discussing. It's only the Holy Spirit comes to, he say, he comes to teach, to guide, and to remind you things that you do not know or you have even forgotten. There are things that you have heard 10 years, 15 years ago, but when you allow yourself for the Spirit to come into you,
that's where growth is.
That's where the growth comes.
When I was a child, I taught as a child. So the previous thinking of me fighting this, you put it away.
And then
when you become an adult, an adult is not talking about age, it's talking about spiritual maturity.
And that is where the renewal of the mind
exactly.
begin to renew each and every day. The more you study, the more you allow yourself for the Spirit to guide you, then it renews your mind day in and day out, because there are more things that you need to know. There are more mysteries. There are more revelations in the Word. But until you make yourself available for the Spirit to use you,
that's true,
you won't get to that knowledge. So what is it? The power we don't carry is because we think we don't carry anything.
Exactly. But if you look at the scriptures, very
we carry something.
Yes, not say what if we are alive.
So you can carry your Moses.
Oh, that was a great contribution, Minister. That was a great contribution. So now we know that, as for principalities, please don't even mention their name. You have power over them.
I would say, when I was a child,
you thought like a child.
You see, so but now you are no more.
Exactly. Anytime principality shows up in your dream, tell them
you are no more than
Jesus
child.
Has already defeated you. Exactly. If you have anybody to fight, you should have fought Jesus and won. If you couldn't win with Jesus, it's impossible.
It's impossible.
No, no.
For you to win,
they can't even fight you, because the gap between you and them, the Bible says,
is far,
far above. It's not just far.
Above the heavenly range. So, what can you compare to?
Exactly. You have to know this position. Stand there. Therefore, stand. So you stand in this position, and then you pray like that. When you come to prayer. Well, we are not saying these things and discouraging people from prayer.
No.
This is to shape our prayer life. This is to make our prayer lives better. So that when you stand and you are praying, you know what to say.
And you know the words.
You know exactly.
You need to speak.
Exactly.
It's not just the prayer you pray. It's the way that you speak that makes the prayer.
If you have a weapon and then you don't have bullets, what good is the weapon? The weapons of our warfare.
Yeah.
What weapon do you have? And what bullets are in the weapon? Because it's the bullets that makes the weapon effective.
And you know your target.
Exactly.
So know the words you use.
So that we are not ignorant of the schemes of the devil.
So as Pastor Amua said earlier, because of certain things that we have in unforgiving spirit.
The bitterness.
Bitterness.
Yeah, unforgiving.
So when you are
pride,
you are hitting
last of the flesh.
You are praying and you have this thing in you. The devil will be laughing at you.
See who is fighting
because
the devil.
You haven't put on the full armor.
Exactly.
Maybe you have put on to cover your head, your chest, but when you want to get to your arms or whatever, you can't, because there are certain things.
The devil knows when to press.
Exactly.
You have unforgiveness in your heart. Mm-hmm. Jesus said, the God of this world cometh, but he found nothing in me. So if the devil comes
and he finds nothing in you,
then you are fully armed.
Exactly.
That is where the armor is. But if the devil comes and you have bitterness, unforgiveness, malice, hypocrisy, pride,
by
lust, then the devil knows there's a hole somewhere. And you'll be praying, looking into the sky, thinking there's a principality there. The principality is already in you. The unforgiveness
is in you.
Is the principality. That's what the Bible says. Give no place. Give no place. The moment you allow these things to come in you, you have given the devil a place.
And one small place,
the devil doesn't need much. All he needs is one opportunity.
And say, watch and pray. Watch and pray.
Exactly.
So that you do not fall into
temptation.
Because the devil can tempt you in some other schemes that he will use against you. But you see, there are many. The schemes are many.
But I can not.
And to put on the full armor, as Pastor Amua said, you got to be very careful with little things that you ignore.
Exactly.
Already,
you can't harbor hate in your heart and tell me if you
this is nothing. I can fight the devil without this thing. But that is where he uses his schemes
against you. Hello, my master. Hello. Hello, what's that?
I'm telling you. Mm-hmm. As we are still where we are we conquerors? Because the chair is already occupied in our hand. Did you to me? I'm my yes, but never my yeah. I'll bet the time when we two year old, I will see. You will see, you know, there was a little tea in the book, and I never see a couple. Was it your tea in the moon? Then the moon was sitting all we are.
Minister, the discussion has gotten to a level where even continuing is a problem. You know, sometimes you just have to allow the Holy Spirit
to do his work.
Exactly. Do the Lord said what he do was to contribute.
And so, come on. Yeah, let them let them come.
But listeners in
the listeners.
Exactly. We thank God that gradually we are increasing the knowledge. We thank God. But again, young kind, but could be soon come on up.
Okay.
Darkness, in fact, darkness is maybe a new
one.
Okay. This darkness is talking about a group of people being.
Where we are, we haven't finished
the John 3, 19.
19. John 3, 19.
Okay. You want us to read that part again?
No, we are in Ephesians 1, isn't it?
Ephesians 1, in Ephesians, that was in support of the principalities.
So with that.
We will come back to that part.
Okay. Where are we now?
We want to read the last scripture for the darkness, the rulers of darkness.
So that's Ephesians 6.
No, that is 1 Peter.
1 Peter.
1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 9 and 10. This is for believers to know that we were once in darkness. When the Bible talks about rulers of darkness, that was where we were. You see, that's why when Jesus rose up, he said, I have given you power. Therefore, go into the world. Because he knew that he had made us light. And we needed to go into the dark world. Darkness. And going into darkness, no one goes to the house of a strong man and gets the possessions of the strong man easily. This is what Ephesians is about. You have to bind that strong man. So the God of this world is what the Bible wants us to deal with. The misinformation. That's what
First Peter 2.
Nana, please, let's read 1 Peter 2 and then I'll put you online very quickly. 1 Peter 2, 9 and 10. Then after that, we pick Nana Osebwati. 1 Peter chapter 2. If you want me to read, I can do so. Okay. Nana, thank you for your understanding. The Bible says that, but ye are a chosen generation. He's talking about children of God. A royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that we should show forth the praise of him who has called us out of darkness So that was where we were, into his marvelous light. So as Jesus has called us out of darkness, Ephesians 6 is for us to also the ruler of darkness, that darkness where we used to be. We have to go back
and bring those
and it is not going to be easy. That is why we need the armor. Okay, so very clearly we now see what the armor is about. The armor is not to stay in church and to be praying against people who are even asleep, calling them witches. So Ephesians clearly also tells us that.
Let's finish the 10.
Okay. Verse 10. Okay, let me read the 9 again and then we will end with the 10. But ye are chosen generation, royal priesthood, a holy nation, peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous. He called the light marvelous. He didn't say light. He said into his marvelous light. 10. Which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God. In time past, we were in darkness. Anyone who is in darkness is not God's person. It's not God's child. That is what Peter is saying. But now, we are God's people. We are God's children. Which had not obtained mercy, but now we have obtained mercy. So whatever we are now, whatever we've got now, it is
we should bring those people
a burden on us to go and bring those people in the dark world.
So they can also obtain mercy.
Exactly. So that's what the rulers of darkness are about. So we are against the rulers, not the darkness. Let's pick
we need to have clear. I need to ask some questions, but let Nana,
please.
Nana comes on first.
Hello, Nana.
Hello, a very good evening.
Good evening, Nana.
And it's been a long time.
A long time. Long time. Yeah.
Every word of God is pure, and it's a shield for those who put their
because you know, did you put your trust fully in it? Because what they eat, I'm a transfer. What they eat, they bring, I'm a transfer. It is Nyama and Koye. And I say, we don't go Christian, you know, and Nyama Koye, man, all Christian, but you know, so I don't want to bring them. Check yourself. Christianity is not individual. We learn from each other, and so you come back to yourself and analyze, pray to God, put your fingers crossed, and the good one will be one. Say, Ebemuana, what take it? What take it? Also, no, God is true. God is so powerful.
If you have a very important question, I think
my,
you have to deal with it before.
I don't want to rush into it, but okay. If time was this First Peter 2:9-10.
Yeah.
Based on what we just picking up from Ephesians.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let me pick one more color, please. I think there's a color.
Okay.
Hello, good evening and welcome to Bless Radio UK.
Hello.
Hello.
Christ has been a kind of woman.
Oh.
If I jump in the marriage, Evangelist Mary.
Evangelist Mary Aqua.
But I.
Oh, welcome.
As we kind of woman.
As we being kind of woman.
Yes, I see. And I said, I'm in here. But my better so, and then my friends, so I can't crack. What the believers need to know, part two. Kakra me kan se a Christopher de ye also ye hun se si an se ye wo awiye brim ye wo awiye brim enti no over John 9:57 na wo se wona wo pe bibia ye ansa na wo be di Christo akiri ti on krofo bebre wo wona ma ye gwa son dem ma agen satra so fulu wet me si so a but nipa no ofa nya djuma ti de hia se si a ye an pe chiri. Was he a bass or numb coin or a chrono? Obi Catcherno said, a rather one about you on your Caribbean. Obi Catcher is a rather, maybe a rather chrono, maybe watchy. I used to say once a sacrama or a tune, a real mamma will prove when he papa neither be or any tibato. Christopher Bass as he so no. Bible said 33 years guy, one sit dying, one see a boss now and to talk us. But any punk as I'm sure rather. And then the pan ya jenny say a bedi Christo chi a dear di Christo chi over the tray and the chi. And near Madada Brabo Dada Abrabo fi Abrabo Kanka and your Madada no and no na ye ni say di chi. But did your Christopher was a see and ya hun say you will be yet blue. Bible sit uba yen yuna yun uba yes soa yes no trouble do dear or bafiwa fan moon. And Jimaso Kakra mechan say Christopher ye ya hope chili look nas is the true now. Or since you didn't start so soon, Funtun that the other channel even a Jimon. On Fatania, go on here. If the answer ever fired, yes, such a who's a crystal name here. Because my class only 10 years, 5 years. So for catching them, he said,
I'm so proud of you, my sister.
Evangelist
Akwa, thank you. God bless you. But your next meeting, you better to work with me.
God bless you.
Yes. Again, I'm so excited. Our dear people in Christ are coming out to voice their opinion about this topic. Hello, Pastor Amor.
Yes, sir.
Pastor Pacho Mononko. Hello, Pastor.
I said you should send your link to me so that I will watch you on YouTube so that I will follow what you are discussing, but I couldn't get it.
I think I send it late.
Okay, please, Minister Kingsley will send it to you.
I've sent it, but I think he received. I didn't see the message earlier, but I've sent it.
So sorry about that, please.
Alright.
Yeah, please try and subscribe to the channel so that when we go live, you can easily get notification.
Yeah, I'll subscribe to it.
God bless you so much, Pastor. God bless you. Thank you. Minister.
Yes.
Because of our time. A question. Na yen deal with it because there's more. We will come back and continue next week.
I don't want to rush.
No.
Gradually.
First Peter.
What we just read.
First Peter chapter 2, verse 9 and 10.
Yeah.
But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness. That is where I take delight in. He called me out of darkness into his wonderful light.
Okay. The 10 is where I want to ask questions or we can get a little bit understand. Well, now we are talking about darkness. That's from Ephesians 6, darkness. So the 10 is saying, once
we were not a people.
Once we were not people. And then.
But now.
You are
the people of God.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Once you have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy.
Okay. This is where I want to ask my question. Now we have to be first. We are not God
before.
We are not. Now we are. And there's a lot of people out there which were the same people with them and they are still there.
Powerful. I know where you're going.
And now we have mercy. And we are leaving those people to still be where they are, still in darkness with no mercy. And we go and sit in the church for ourselves, and we are fighting against the principalities, the darkness.
Your good friends.
These are the people who are in the darkness, where once upon a time we were with these people, where we are not God's people.
Sadly, now we are.
And now we are God's people, and we know that once upon a time we are the same people with these people. But when we are praying this efficiency,
you don't even pray for them.
We pray for fighting with the devil. Because he is our target.
My goodness.
The devil is our target, fighting, because we think the devil owns us something. He has taken something from us that we are praying to take that thing from the darkness, because he has hidden something that belongs to me.
Yes, in the darkness.
So I'm praying for that principalities, those powers in darkness, to get my things from that darkness. But this quotation have opened my understanding.
Praise God.
To come to know that once upon a time, I was in a God's
people. You were not part of God's people.
I was in the darkness.
Exactly. We did not have mercy. Now we have mercy.
Now, so what are we doing to bring those people? That is my question.
The light.
That is.
The Bible calls it marvelous light. You see, if you look at the
marvelous, wonderful light. You see, this wonderful light, do you want to only share it with yourself? But what about those people? You knew them. So once upon a time, you know that you are in the same boat with them.
But God called us out of darkness. When we were controlled by the ruler of darkness.
So if the Bible says, we are fighting this person, not thinking about we are fighting, we are praying against
the ruler. But we are not going out there to bring the people out of darkness. And we've not even seen the ruler before. That's we don't even know who the ruler is.
That's where my question is. The best thing.
That is why, Brother Ken, because of time.
Because of time.
We will look at the kind of prayer that God advocates for His children,
so that we can pray to overcome this.
Exactly, and that prayer will cover every aspect of your life by the grace of God. You see, this Ephesians, it tells us that we should pray all kinds of prayer.
Oh yes.
So we will see what all kinds of prayer.
That's why is that Philippians 4:6. Pray all kinds of prayer. Make requests, your requests
known
to God.
Exactly.
With all.
Exactly.
With all. Exactly. With all kinds of prayer. Make your petition. All kinds. So, what prayer do we pray?
You see.
We will get
it. Will be interesting.
I will stop here next week.
When we get there, you know that your request is made by the Holy Spirit.
Exactly.
It should not be made by your carnal mind, because your carnal mind will ask things that are carnal.
I was reading Romans 8, 27. Romans 27. When the Spirit leads us to pray, because we missed, we pray amiss.
Exactly.
So, Pastor Amoa is
Pastor Amoa. Okay. Maybe he will be our last caller. And then
we'll just pick him up.
Yes.
Oh.
Have you already picked him?
I have. Yeah.
Oh my God. Hello, Pastor.
Yes, sir.
Welcome back. I think you'll be our last caller for today.
Thank you, sir. Can I contribute more?
Yes,
please.
Yes, you can.
Go ahead.
Okay. You know, one thing that we have not taken critical look of it. You talk about it more, and I want to add more on it.
Please do.
Sometimes, as you are saying, we think that we are not fighting against flesh and blood, but we are forgetting that we are controlled by the ruler of the world, which is Satan, that God has already assigned for it. And man will not sit and assess himself and see that what the Bible is saying, am I in it or I'm not in it? But although you go and stand at the back, at the corner of his room,
you call it Shege,
against Satan. The same Satan is playing against for. He himself is the demon. When you are coming to God, you should not come to God with any enmity, with any thing within us. But while you are come to God in the morning, you raise someone within you. And you come to bound, I bound Satan. Who is that Satan you're going to bound?
You
are bounding yourself.
Powerful.
But the person is in darkness. And the Bible says, if you are with the same feathers, you fly together. The same birds fly together. At first, we too are in darkness. And by the grace of God, But we are coming up from that darkness. So how are we going to maneuver and bring those who are in the darkness into where we are now? But we are not thinking about those things now. We are thinking about selfishness. I want to be prosper.
I
want to become a rich man. I want to have a mansion. I want to have that. But the Bible has made it clear, seek ye the kingdom of God and its righteousness first, and everything shall be added unto thee. So before the armor of God, you can put it fully. Then you have already thinking of those who are the lost souls. And when you start to be winning souls for Christ, then Christ himself will rise and fight for you. Because the Bible says, sitting for us at the right hand of the Father. So when we know that we ourselves, we can't sit for ourselves, then we should look for someone who can assist us. Then we will intercede for each other. But nowadays it's more like that. You, Mr. Bramosis, that you are colleague with me. I will have a pastor who will stand and tells me that Moses is he possessed. And all my focus is Moses. But I'm forgetting that I'm Moses myself, that possessing myself.
That's interesting.
I will see. I possessing my own self, because immediately I will see my Moses. The first thing will come with me is envy. In our can we say, hey, watch it out. Meanwhile, you are telling that you are a Christian. You have worn the full armor of God with anything in you. How can it work? It can't. So the best thing as we upcoming Christians we can do, always we should put ourselves in a screen, then we should assess ourselves. That the Spirit of God that dwells in me, how am I using the Spirit of God? How the Spirit directs me? Am I listening to what people are saying, or I'm looking for what the Spirit tells me? Are you strict and assess yourself in this way, you see that everything will move according how God wants to use you. So, Moses, there's a little talk I want to talk about with the discussion that we and the little one that I hear. There's a little talk about that I want to make. God bless you.
God bless you, Pastor.
Expanding this topic or this chapter for us, God which bless you.
God bless you.
You have really enlightened me with 2-3 things in this topic. I'm blessed with it. God bless you.
God bless you. Next week you join us again, God's willing. You will be on the line for maybe all the time.
Yeah.
We will put you. Okay. We won't disconnect you next week. God willing, we will hold you on.
God willing, next week.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that you can follow
him. Amen.
Okay.
God bless
you. Okay. God bless you. Sister.
God bless you.
Minister, I think that brings us to the end.
Let's finish it.
We've gone beyond our time today.
We
thank our dear viewers and listeners so much. Please, next week, same time, join us and let's deliberate on the word of God. We will go a bit more deeper. I know some of us we are desperate to know the kind of prayers, because a man of God calls it, but Moses, you know, for this thing you and your big brother are discussing, it's very interesting, you know. It is really making it difficult for me to pray now.
Of course.
These are the kind of things you used to pray.
Yes.
Even when he woke up in the middle of the night, pray against principalities. No. Now he's understood that those people are not a factor. So what is he supposed to pray about now? I said, don't worry.
Let the Spirit lead you to
pray. We will get to that stage and you will enjoy it. The Bible says that pray with that season. He's talking about something. By the grace of God, we will break it down. And then you will enjoy prayer life. You will not wait till all night or Sunday before you go and pray. No. In the same way you speak Chi every day, why can't you pray every day?
Every day. So may the Lord bless you. God bless you. And I was saying, evangelist Alpha, God bless you. We want you. I mean, tonight I've been one of the nights I've really enjoyed this.
Because of the contributions.
For the contribution that is coming.
Evangelist Mariaqua. Powerful contribution.
Mama Esther, I mean, calling twice. I'm so grateful. Thank God for this discussion. And I believe next week we will continue.